today we're talking about this right here. This is chili over rice. I'm gonna show you how I make my version, which is a take on my dad's recipe that he has passed down to me. But first, let's talk about what this dish is and why it's so beloved in my home state of Hawaii. Now, if you're just here to learn how I make this, you can go to this part of the video or click in the description below for the timestamp. So, you can't talk about chili on rice without talking about Zippies.
We're the kind of place you can get the taste you're looking for. Good food, good fun, and a whole lot more. We've got the taste you're hungering for. You can come on over to the taste. Come on in, my friend, Zippy's is your place.
Sorry to abruptly cut off this montage, but it's worth noting that it seems like every Zippy's commercial was made pre-1983 for some reason.
My favorite food is chili because I like chili.
Well, once in a while, I eat chili for breakfast.
Chili.
According to Hawaii Magazine, Zippy's chili is by far their bestseller, which the company sells 110 tons of each month. The chili chicken mix plate, you can get chili spaghetti there. They have a chili grilled cheese now. They have a chili loco moco. There's the chili frank plate, which is a hot dog on top of chili. They also had a chili burrito, I believe, at some point. And so while the commercialized version of Hawaiian food and Hawaiian barbecue is often edited down to poke, chicken katsu plates, and spam musubi, and those are all still super authentic to Hawaii, but I'd say chili on rice is more of a window into the fusion that defines what local Hawaii food is. With white rice coming from the Asian migration that brought my dad's Japanese heritage to the islands, and chili most likely being inspired by the post-World War II military presence on the islands, with canned goods like kidney beans being more prominent in Hawaii pantries. And so because my mom was a military kid, with my grandpa and her whole family being stationed at Hickam Air Force Base on Oahu, I look at a dish like this as a reflection of my own heritage. It's hapa, just like me.
So basically, I was fueled by chili and rice as a kid. We had it at home, and we made daily, if not weekly, trips to Zippy's, where the chili chicken mix plate was one of my go-to orders.
And as you can imagine, I always overlooked my dad's family chili recipe in favor of the crowd favorite Zippy's, and it wasn't until I became an adult and made this dish myself when I came to appreciate this recipe and now actually prefer it over Zippy's.
Let's take a look at the origins of this recipe in this handwritten cookbook that my dad made for me when I moved away from home. I should mention how much of a big deal it was for him to write these recipes down for me. I mean, look at this thing, it's incredible. A few pages in, we have a recipe titled Anna's Chili.
Anna is my younger sister, and to clarify the origins of this recipe, I sent my dad a text, to which he replied, "Hi Maddie, me and Anna created our chili recipe called Anna's Chili while she lived here since fourth grade. It went through different evolutions, beanless, black beans, no garlic, garlic, until it settled into an awesome place. Grandma made chili, but it was plantation style with no spices, but so good for a hungry teenager like me to eat." Gotta love my dad. And by the way, plantation style is not what you think. He's referring to the area we grew up in, which was referred to as the plantations of Hawaii. I grew up in the central part of Oahu, which is where a lot of the produce for the whole state was grown.
So as you can see, the recipe is super basic with a lot of humble ingredients. The one that I'm going to key in on here is the white wine. This is the key ingredient to the chili recipe, in my opinion.
White wine not only brightens up the chili with its acidity, but its sweetness also balances out the beef and the chili powder very well.
So while at its core, my take on this family recipe is very similar, the specific ingredients I use is where mine differs. We're still starting out with chopped onion and garlic. I'm dicing up 2 medium onions and 4 cloves of garlic. If you'd like a step-by-step guide on dicing onions and garlic, click the link in the description where I'll take you through how I do it. After setting aside our diced onions and garlic, I'll prep our beef. I'm using high-quality, grass-fed, 85-15 organic beef here. The quality definitely makes a difference in a simple dish like this. And this is a technique I learned from a video I saw with Chef Isaac Toops, who was on Top Chef. When browning beef for a stew like this, he basically made one big hamburger patty with the meat and seasoned one side with salt and pepper. So now when we have our Dutch oven heating at medium-high, with a sliced bit of oil, I'm gonna start cooking it basically like I would a burger. This ensures optimal browning of our beef, and the crispy bits, just like you get with a burger, really does take this to another level. While that side is browning, I'll season the other side with salt and pepper, and after about 3 to 4 minutes, I'll do my best to flip it over to do the same on the other side. If the meat breaks up here, no worries. We already elevated the chili with the even browning we did on the other side. And after this side browns, I'll start breaking up the meat and then introduce my onions. My dad would drain the meat at this point, but I like the rendered fat here, especially from this high quality beef. So I compensate by using more onions, which will soak up the fat and the flavor. I'll turn down the heat a little bit here to make sure I don't burn the onions. We're cooking this mixture for about another 5 minutes until the onions are translucent. Next, I'll add in our chopped garlic and give it a good stir. We'll cook this for another minute, and this is where I recommend using your hand to catch a whiff of the chili mixture so far. I do this every time. It's an incredible smell. I'll then start incorporating the rest of the ingredients, starting with our canned tomatoes. My dad would use Del Monte tomato sauce, which is great. Really, any tomato sauce works here. I opt for these Bianco tomatoes, which are my favorite canned tomatoes. I have the crushed tomatoes here, and don't discard the can just yet. Next, I'll add 2 cans of kidney beans with the canning liquid, and then I'll add our white wine. My tip here is to use wine that you actually enjoy drinking. That will make this chili your own and cater to your own palate. Ashley and I love this bread and butter Chardonnay. My dad would use Chardonnay as well. I'll use about half of this bottle and pour it in using our tomato can. This is a great way to get the tomato bits that are still in the can into the chili. I know half a bottle of wine seems like a lot, but I'll be simmering this for a couple hours. This is a good amount of liquid for that. And like I said, you want this to taste like white wine in the final product. Last touches are our chili powder, about 2 tablespoons here. Add more if you're using a sweeter wine. And then I add 2 tablespoons of Worcestershire sauce. This is going to give this chili a nice depth of flavor. And then it's basically hands off for 2 hours, and we'll let this simmer on low with the lid on and a small opening for the steam to release, giving it a mix every so often to make sure it doesn't burn.
So that's basically it. Super easy to assemble, as you can see. And you can even make a simplified version of this by just browning some meat and then throwing everything into the pot. You can even replace onions and garlic for onion powder and garlic powder.
This is a great recipe to make as meal prep for the week. We'll often eat this the next day or days after. It just gets better in the fridge. You can also be proactive and right away freeze a portion of this once it's done. That'll make for a great quick dinner down the road. Okay, so to serve, I like to have a good amount of rice. The rice to chili ratio is crucial here. It's almost 2-to-1 rice to chili. This also means this amount of chili will yield a bunch of servings. Mix it around, make that perfect bite of chili coated rice.
Oh man, it's honestly still a top 5 bite for me. Chili like this was born to be served on a hot bed of white rice. I love the texture here of the ground beef with the starchy beans and the hot white rice. I get spicy, I get meaty, I get tomato-y, I get sweet. Really the full gamut of flavors here are reflected in this chili. And this white rice just perfectly soaks up all those flavors. And the flavors are so perfectly balanced. I can taste everything that we put in that pot for that long simmer, with the white wine creating that balancing act. So if you grew up like I did, eating chili rice, you definitely gotta give this recipe a try. And if you've never had chili on rice, this is now your entry point into one of Hawaii's local favorites. Oh man, it just gets better over time too. This has been in the fridge for like a few days now. I still love Zippy's chili. I have it every time I'm back home. But what this recipe taught me is that we shouldn't overlook our family recipes. They're passed down to us for a reason. And on top of that, if you end up making something that you actually prefer over one of your childhood favorites, to me, that's what cooking's all about. Make it your own and it will be your new favorite, something you made by yourself for yourself. And if you end up making this chili yourself, it would be great if you could tag me on Instagram, @MattyTries. It would be great to see the chili rice love spread all over social media. Thank you so much for watching. Just getting to the end of these videos means you're supporting me and helping YouTube recommend my content to more viewers. And if you'd like to go further, go ahead and like this video, maybe throw a comment below, maybe give me your go-to Zippy's order if you've been there. I'll be back next week with another recipe video for all you home cooks out there. These come every Thursday. See you on the next one.